Can I have the appearances, please?
If the Commission pleases, Farooq Initial Care, I seek permission to appear for the applicant, Mr. Transom.
Thanks, Mr. Farooq.
If it pleases the Commission, Nick Ruskin, I seek leave to appear for the second respondent and Mr. Tall.
Thanks, Mr. Ruskin. Is permission sought on the basis of having regard to the complexity of the matter and be more efficiently dealt with if permission were granted?
Yes, Your Honour, it is. There are some elements in relation to whether or not certain conduct is at work that involves some degree of complexity. And in those circumstances, in my respectful submission, it's appropriate that the Commission exercises its discretion to grant third party permission.
Okay. Do you agree, Mr. Russell?
Yeah, and on this occasion, I concur with my learned colleague.
All right. Permission is granted on that basis. Have you had a discussion about who's going first?
Yes, Your Honour. It's proposed that I'd go first and present the case. If the Commission pleases, this is an application by Mr. Transom for stop bullying orders under Section 789F of the Fair Work Act. Your Honour will have, I think, the statement of agreed facts which has been filed by the parties.
I do.
A witness statement of Mr. Transom, which is dated the 7th of April 2015, and a doctor certificate dated the 7th of April 2015. If it is convenient to the tribunal, I have copies of those documents that I can hand up.
Sure, thank you.
Those are the documents that the applicant intends to rely upon in these proceedings. It may be convenient, Your Honour, to mark the statement of agreed facts now. I propose to attend to the witness statement through my witness.
Sure.
I'll call him.
I'll mark the statement of agreed facts, Joint Exhibit 1.
Your Honour, the first respondent pipeline is the employer of my client. It is a labour hire contractor for the maintenance and construction work in the offshore gas industry. It is contracted by Lacking Energy, which is the second respondent, on various projects to perform certain services related to construction and maintenance. Mr. Steve Tall is an employee of Lacking Energy. My client, Mr. Transom, has been employed by Pipeline since November 2008 as a scaffolder, and since that time has been deployed by Pipeline on various Lacking Energy projects. The present application relates to a project which commenced in terms of my client's work on the 11th of February 2015. It is another offshore project with Lacking Energy. My client's roster, Mr. Transom, is a 1 week on, 1 week off roster. It is during this particular project that I allege that my client, Mr. Transom, has been the victim of bullying by Mr. Stephen Tall. And it's that conduct and associated conduct by other employees who are performing work on the project that we seek orders from this tribunal. We propose to call one witness, Your Honour, and that is the applicant himself, Mr. Transom. I propose in a moment to summarise the essence of the allegations, but before I do so, I would just ask Your Honour to take particular note of the circumstance of this particular work. It is offshore work, where workers in their rostered week on effectively live on site on the offshore facility. There's literally no getting away, Your Honour, from the circumstances and the interactions of your workplace in that particular environment of offshore work. In my respectful submission, Mr. Tall's bullying behaviour, which I'll outline shortly, is no small matter. My client is a man of small stature, is 5 feet tall. He has been repeatedly, as the witness statement will set out, being targeted and harassed by Mr. Tall by reason of his height. This behaviour occurred during the second rotation of my client's placement on the particular project. The particular first incident of bullying behaviour occurred while workers, including my client and Mr. Tall, were watching a popular mini-series known as The Game of Thrones. On that particular incident, you'll hear evidence that Mr. Tall pointed at my client, called him the imp, and effectively incited other workers to laugh at my client. This reference to the imp is an apparent reference to a character from the Game of Thrones, a character of very small stature. This conduct was, in those circumstances, humiliating and embarrassing for my client, and conduct of a similar nature was repeated on subsequent occasions, including on the next day when my client, whilst performing work, is told to stand up when he's working. There are then a cascading series of events whereby Mr. Tall continues to make jokes about my client's height. Other workers join in. He's frequently called the imp or Lord Lannister, once again a reference to this character from the miniseries Game of Thrones. There is a further incident which indeed occurs off-site in an off-week, an incident which occurs at a local pub known as the Methane, when my client is then, on that particular occasion, subjected to behaviour by Mr. Tall, whereby Mr. Tall yells at my client and incites other people to make comments which are directed at my client's stature. It's an incident which caused him to feel humiliated, Your Honour.
Do you allege that that incident occurred while he was at work?
We don't allege that that incident occurred whilst at work, but we say it is materially relevant, Your Honour, to the degree to which the tribunal can assess that there is a continuing risk of such behaviour occurring at work. And so we say it is relevant for that particular purpose, Your Honour, and the Commission should take that conduct into account in assessing the type of order that it need make in these particular circumstances. That's how we put its relevance. My client reports the conduct to his manager at Pipeline, Mr. Bob Ledger. It's fair to say from the evidence which will fall from my client that the response of the company is less than overwhelming in terms of dealing with the immediacy of the impact upon my client.
Is Pipeline represented?
Yes, Your Honour.
All right, thanks, Ms. Cantilever.
It's a circumstance, Your Honour, where the company, and the evidence we'll disclose, is much more concerned with issues of business continuity than the health and safety of my client. The issue of health and safety, Your Honour, is not put in any abstract way in this particular matter. We're not talking about the mere perception of risk here. We are talking about actual impact. Through my client, I will tender a medical certificate from his treating general practitioner, Dr. Hammerhead, which indicates that Mr. Transome is suffering symptoms associated with extreme stress and anxiety. So we're dealing with a very real circumstance of negative impact upon my client in terms of his well-being, indeed his health. We say that having regard to the material, the evidence that Your Honour will hear, that the jurisdictional prerequisites are made out for the making of an order in the present matter, including that there was bullying at work, being repeated unreasonable behaviour, and that conduct occurred at work. There's a risk to health and safety, as I've outlined. Furthermore, we say that the discretionary considerations will give rise to, well, my respectful submission, should cause the Commission to exercise its discretion to make the order, having regard to the, in particular, the continuing risk that my client faces and the failure of the company to adequately deal with the problem in a prompt and appropriate manner. I have, Your Honour, the minute of proposed order that we would propose be made in this matter should the Commission exercise its discretion. I've given a copy to my learned friend before the hearing today, and I will hand up a copy now to the tribunal.
Thank you. Just bear with me for a moment, Mr. Farooq. Thank you. Mr. Ruskin, I note from the statement of agreed facts that it's not contested that Mr. Tall did on occasion make comments and jokes about the applicant's height, and that he and other workers did pat the applicant on the head from time to time.
That's correct, Your Honour. It's also not in dispute, perhaps contrary to what my learned friend said, that both the first and second respondents were very concerned about the allegations made by the applicant and acted immediately to commence an investigation. We say this, Your Honour, this is a premature application. My clients, both the second respondent and Mr. Tall, have effectively just been notified of this matter. The second respondent was notified of this matter, and the next moment this application came before this tribunal, notwithstanding that, as the agreed facts say, that there would be an immediate investigation by the first respondent and the second respondent. This application concerns an off-site an offshore gas plant, and the facts of the plant have been described by my learned friend correctly, but I will add this. It is a multi-million dollar facility. It is a serious Australian project, creates many, many jobs and much revenue for this country. It has complex IR arrangements. It is, and I will come to this later, a robust environment, as it has been described. People are doing their best for this project. It's very pressured. They are living with one another. They let off steam. And there are jokes galore, as we will see. And the Australian culture of not taking oneself too seriously is very much at play here. There's a lot of interaction back and forth, which, as I say, eases the pressure of the project. Out of that multiplicity of witticisms, gags, fun, and pressure, an aggrieved person who has worked on such sites as this, a highly respected scaffolder, the applicant, claims that he's been bullied because of his height. Now, Your Honour, there is much injustice in this world. There is bigotry and violence, and we must consider, or with respect, you must consider this application about the facts of this matter in the context of a plant where there is much Australian banter. There is no, even at its worst, the conduct is not conduct of serious bullying in any respect. We will say that the banter was just banter. No one was put upside down in a rubbish bin. There was no, we say, real physical contact. It was words, and it was meant in good fun. We say it was not bullying. We certainly, as the agreed facts state, contend that these things, some of these things were said. That is true, we don't deny that. But the question is, was it unreasonable behaviour? And that seems to us to be the key issue. But behaviour in this robust environment must be taken into account. In our view, the application is unnecessary. And if you find, Your Honour, that this behaviour is such a thing as called bullying, then it will be a high watermark of what is expected in workplaces today. We say the application must fail on the basis that we have barely started the investigation. We say too, on this question of reasonableness, that it was not evident that the applicant, until now, had any concerns about anything particularly to do with his height. And now my clients know that he says he doesn't wish comments to be made about his height. No reference to his height will be made because no ill intent was ever intended. He may say he's sensitive about his height, as he does, but it was not obvious, indeed the contrary. In the circumstances, the conduct cannot be considered unreasonable and because of the objective test required. As to the order that is proposed, we say the order should simply not be made on the basis that there is no risk that the worker will continue to be bullied at work to the extent that, which we deny has been, that the worker will be bullied at work because Mr. Tall, and I say on behalf of my client, will assert there will be no reference now about height. Please, the Commission.
Did you want to say anything, Ms. Cantilever?
Yes, Your Honour. I have a prepared statement, if that's all right, Your Honour.
Sure.
I have been employed as a human resource manager at Pipeline Contractors the 15th of September 1996, and I have read Mr. Transom's application and his witness statement dated the 7th of April 2015, and state as follows. The first I heard of the bullying was after Tom spoke to Bob Ridger, manager of Pipeline, on Friday the 3rd of April. Bob advised me that the situation flared up at the Methane, a local hotel, where Tom said he went to celebrate his birthday with some friends and co-workers from Pipeline. Bob arranged a meeting with myself and Tom for the 6th of April 2015. We spoke to Tom about what had happened offshore as well as at the Methane. And we asked Tom why he hadn't raised his concerns when the bullying first started, and he indicated he just wanted it to stop. He thought that if he ignored it, it would go away, and he was trying to be the bigger man. Bob and I told Tom that we would investigate his claims in accordance with our anti-bullying policy, and that we'd also need to discuss his allegations with management at Lacking Energy. Tom then told us that he was reluctant to go offshore on his next rotation, which was starting on Wednesday, the 8th of April 2015. Bob then explained to Tom that although we are concerned about his allegations, there was no one else available with his skills and we couldn't replace him on the next rotation at such short notice. I pointed out that this was the first we have heard of the allegations, even though it had apparently been occurring since the first rotation back in February. I tried to get Tom to understand that the contract Pipeline has with Lacking Energy is reliant on Pipeline meeting specific deadlines. And Pipeline gets a lot of work through Lacking Energy, and it's important to us to keep that relationship strong. On the 8th of April 2015, Tom did not arrive to go offshore for the next work rotation. Instead, he sent us a doctor's certificate and advised us that he had made a claim to the Fair Work Commission. As Tom's employer, we will make every effort to ensure he feels safe and secure at his workplace. And although I'm disappointed in Tom that he hasn't given us the opportunity to deal with this issue through our internal processes, as we had only just heard about the bullying and we're trying to work out the most appropriate way to deal with these concerns, Pipeline will be supportive of any recommendation the Fair Work Commission makes in order to fix this situation.
Do you have a copy of your statement there?
Yes, I do, Your Honour.
Okay. Mr. Ruskin, Mr. Farouk, have you seen the statement?
Yes, Your Honour.
Do you have any questions or...?
No, Your Honour.
You contend for it to be admitted? I'll mark that exhibit, Pipeline 1.
Pipeline 1.
Ms. Cantilever, how long would it take you to conduct the investigation that you've referred to?
We believe about a week or 10 days, Your Honour.
All right. Thank you. Mr. Farouk, do you want to call your first witness?
If Your Honour pleases, I call my first witness, Mr. Tom Transy.
Oath, please.
Take this in your hand. Please state your full name and address.
Hi, Tom Transon of 12 Cherry Picker Lane in Gantry, Victoria.
And repeat after me. I swear by Almighty God.
I swear by Almighty God.
That the evidence I shall give.
That the evidence I shall give.
In this matter before the Commission.
In this matter before the Commission.
Will be the truth.
Will be the truth.
The whole truth.
The whole truth.
And nothing but the truth.
And nothing but the truth.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Transon, can you state your full name?
Tom Transon.
And your address?
12 Cherry Picker Lane, Gallantry.
Mr. Transon, have you made a witness statement in this matter?
Yes, I have.
Can I show you this document?
Your Honour, at this point, I'd like to make an objection to the content of the witness statement. Witness statement of Mr. Transon deals in paragraphs 14 to 18, most of 18, with matters to do with his birthday celebrations at a local pub called the Methane, which is onshore, and those events, as I think my learned friend has conceded, have got nothing to do with work. Your decision in Bowker and DP World did decide about the scope of what is work and what is not work. I can take you to that decision, Your Honour, but I think with the concession by my learned friend, this is not an event that is at work. So, assuming that is conceded, perhaps I can deal with the question of why, of my learned friend's suggestion that it should be included. The purpose of these proceedings is to deal with matters that are at work. They shouldn't be regulating matters that are not at work. And evidence about what happens to private lives outside of work, we say, are not relevant and shouldn't be part of these proceedings.
As I understood Mr. Farouk's opening, he wasn't contending that the incident at the methane
yes.
Amounted to bullying conduct at work.
Right.
He was advancing it on the basis that it was evidence, if you like, of a propensity or future risk.
Yes, but what goes on in private life shouldn't be a matter that's relevant here. Whatever the parties do outside work shouldn't be used to say, oh, therefore it will go on at work. It shouldn't be. Otherwise, we'll have before this tribunal matters that are unrelated to work, but which people contend show what the relationship is truly between parties. And I don't think, Your Honour, that that's an appropriate issue. I think it does colour the matter before you in the sense that it deals with perhaps different conduct that took place because it was not at work, and it shouldn't be used to infect this process. And we ask that those paragraphs not be included in any paragraphs of any of the other witnesses which touch upon this issue.
All right. Mr. Frew?
Your Honour, in my submission, the material is pressed on the basis that the conduct is relevant to the issue of risk or propensity, as Your Honour indicated, particularly in these circumstances. We're dealing with an offshore oil and gas facility. Workers stay on that facility during hours which are not strictly in the course of performing work. They are at common recreational facilities on the site, on the plant. And in that regard, the conduct which occurred at the methane, albeit not at the work recreational facility, bears upon the likelihood or propensity that this type of conduct might occur in those particular circumstances. And in my submission, it is relevant for that reason. It is also relevant for the reason that it indicates a certain state of mind on the part of Mr. Tall as to how he would interact with my client, Mr. Transome. And it is relevant to the assessment of the degree of risk and the need, in my respectful submission, to make an order in these circumstances.
I agree with Mr. Ruskin. The paragraph should be struck out. I'd make a couple of observations. The first is that it's conceded that the conduct which took place at the methane on the 2nd of April was not conduct which occurred at work. As for the conduct going to the state of mind of Mr. Tall, I note that on his own evidence, Mr. Transome observes that Mr. Tall and the others were quite drunk at the time, so I'm not persuaded that it goes to state of mind. As to evidence about propensity and frequency, I note that the other alleged conduct which did occur at work appears on the face of Mr. Transome's statement to have occurred on three separate rotations, and that ought to be sufficient to establish that fact. So I'll uphold the objection and strike out paragraphs 14 to 17. Any other objections?
No, Your Honour.
No? All right, the statement can be put to the witness.
Yes. Mr. Transome, can you look at that document, Mr. Transome?
Yes.
Is that the statement that you've made in this proceeding?
It is indeed.
I want to take you to, if you could take pay attention to the fact that paragraphs 14 to paragraph 17 will not be admitted by the Commission. You understand that?
Yes.
Okay. Excluding those paragraphs, can you say that the contents of this statement are true and correct in every particular?
Yes, I can.
I tender that document.
Mark that Exhibit A1.
Now, in paragraph 22 of your statement, you refer to a doctor certificate?
Yes.
Yes. Can you turn to the attachment to your witness statement? That's a medical certificate from Dr. Hammerhead?
That certainly is, yes.
Is that the medical certificate that you referred to in paragraph 22 of your witness statement?
Yes, it is.
I tender that certificate, Your Honour. I have just a couple of questions for the witness, Your Honour. Mr. Transome, can I take you to paragraph 9 of your witness statement?
Yes.
You set out there that about a conversation you had with Mr. Tall while you were constructing the scaffold together.
Yes.
And a comment that he made. What can you describe what you were doing at the time?
We were standing around putting the scaffolding together. I was essentially just trying to get on with the job, and then that's when he made the comment.
Okay, thank you. And in paragraph 13 of your witness statement, you refer to your fourth rotation, and you've said there that you were paranoid that one of your co-workers was either going to comment on your height or pat you on the head without warning.
Yes, I was.
Okay. Can you say, did any of that conduct occur during the fourth rotation?
It did indeed.
Yes. Okay. Thank you for that. I have no further questions for the witness, Your Honour.
Thanks, Mr. Farooq. Mr. Ruskin.
Thank you, Your Honour. Mr. Transome, you are a very good scaffolder, aren't you?
I'd like to think so.
And you've had many years on work sites
as a
scaffolder, have you not?
Yes.
And you would say, wouldn't you, that you're well-liked, even-tempered person?
I would agree to that.
Yeah. Which is a great quality, isn't it?
Yes, I believe it is a good quality.
Yeah. And now you say that you are short, I think the word is. That's maybe so, but you're physically strong, aren't you? You've got very broad shoulders, and no one would want to take you on, would they?
I wouldn't say I agree to that. I'm quite short, so I believe that people wouldn't really see me as a threat in any kind of altercation.
Yeah, but what about those things? Shoulders, very impressive. Pretty scary, don't you think? You're a pretty impressive sort of guy.
Thank you, but no, I don't consider myself
don't see
to
that.
Be...
Would you be surprised if I said other people see you that way?
I'll be very surprised.
Mm-hmm. Now, do you like jokes? Do you like to laugh?
I like the joke as much as the next guy.
Good, yep. Because you're a pretty witty sort of guy, I understand, aren't you? You crack people up, which is a wonderful quality, isn't it?
From time to time, I may have said a joke.
It's wonderful. Now, there's reference to this video that was watched when you were off duty at the work site, and the Game of Thrones. And there's a character called the Imp, who you would have watched that you watched this series with your colleagues. Did you not?
I did.
Yeah. Now, the Imp, I understand, is not tall. That's
no.
Right. But he's pretty heroic, isn't he? He's a pretty terrific guy. If you remember the scene, you might remember it, where I think the king was going to dispose of some young maiden in distress, and all the courtiers were willing to go along with the king. And who came along and saved her? Do you know who came along and saved her?
I believe it was Lord Lannister.
Who is the Imp, is it not?
That is correct.
He's a heroic guy, isn't he?
He is.
And he's mentally strong, and he's decent, and he's a hero. Everything one would want to be. Isn't that right?
Yes.
Cute. Now, you're a good-looking guy, aren't you?
Thank you.
Yeah. If I said to you that you remind me and my instructors of George Clooney, would you be upset by that? Would you find that upsetting?
Possibly, because I think you might be taking the mickey out of me if you said something like that.
But you're a good-looking person. You have the characteristics of George Clooney. You don't accept that you do?
Oh, To be honest with you, it's the first time I've heard such generous comments about myself.
All right. Now, in recent times you've been, if I may say, glowing in your life, because I understand you have recently made an acquaintance of a new girlfriend, Sleet White, is that right?
Yes, that is correct.
Yes. And she's a delightful person, isn't she?
She is.
Yes. And I understand, Mr. Transon, that you've got a bit of a reputation with people, with women. Isn't that right? You're a bit of a, you know, aren't you?
Well, I object to this line of questioning, Your Honour. It seems to bear little relevance at all to the matters at issue in the proceeding and seem designed to simply embarrass my client.
Well, on the contrary, Your Honour, it's not seeking to do. It's trying to describe the person that we are dealing with today, the person who says that he has been the subject of this taunting and bullying. I am showing through the statements that he makes that he isn't just a short person. There's many other aspects to him which should be taken into account.
Well, I think you've made that point, so you might move on.
I think I have to. Thank you, Your Honour. Now, let's talk about the first incident that you describe. In paragraph 8 of your statement, you say, when you were offshore, there was a comment about a joke that my client, Mr. Tall, made, and you said that I chose to laugh along with the rest.
I did.
And tried to ignore it, hoping it would be a one-off comment. So you did. You did laugh at the suggestion that you were the imp, did you not?
I merely cracked a smile or laughed in that
circumstance. Well, you said the statement that you've sworn up to, you have sworn up to this, says
yes.
You laughed. Did you not laugh?
Yes, I laughed it off.
Thank you. Okay. And don't you think that self-deprecation is a very Australian quality?
It can be.
Yeah. And you're very Australian, aren't you? You're a good Aussie bloke.
I was born in Australia.
Yeah.
I'm a good person.
So you agree on the first occasion when you laughed, no one had any idea that the comment that was made was anything but funny from your point of view, isn't that right?
Well, I object to that question because it's asking my client the witness to speculate as to the state of mind of others.
Yeah.
And
No, I agree.
Don't you agree that you laughed and you gave no indication yourself that you didn't have any concern with the comment?
I felt I didn't have any other option at that point in time.
Well, that's not the question with respect.
Well, my respectful submission, the witness should be allowed to answer the question.
Well, he's not answering the question. That's Mr. Ruskin's point. Put the question again, Mr. Ruskin.
The question is this. When you laughed, you gave no indication to any of the people around you that you had any concern with that comment.
No, and may I explain why?
Well, I think I'm happy with the no. Mr.
Mr. Farooq
can
ask you questions in re-examination.
Now, if you tell a joke and I laugh, you can presume that I appreciated the joke. Isn't that right?
Yes.
Thank you. You know the expression, laugh, and the whole world laughs with you? Do you agree with that?
I am.
Okay. And I put to you that after the first occasion, which you concede, about which you laughed, and which you say you gave no indication of concern, that throughout this episode, you gave no indication to anybody that you were concerned or offended by these remarks.
I didn't think I could, so no.
No, you didn't. Thank you. Now, there's humour in the workplace where you work, is there not?
Yes, there is.
Yes. Yep. Mr. Tall, you know Mr. Tall? That's Mr. Tall. He wears glasses, doesn't he?
Yes.
Isn't it the case that you made funny comments about his glasses on occasions?
I don't recall.
You don't recall that? Okay.
Making such a statement.
Well, we'll see what he has to say about that. If you don't tell anybody or demonstrate that you are any way offended by the comment, can you tell me how anyone is to know, after your first laughter, that you are offended? And isn't it the opposite?
Well, normally places of employment would have like a bullying policy that would say that these things aren't allowed to make comments of their physical appearance. And I was shocked and scared at the time that I didn't feel that I could.
You think there should be a policy that says employees should not make comments about people's height, even if they laugh. Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Thank you. Now, obviously, you've been 5 foot all your working life, haven't you?
Yes.
Yes. And it's not the first time that people may have noticed that you are perhaps not as tall as some other people. Isn't that right?
It is.
Yes. And so I put to you that you're well known on these projects, aren't you? As a person, as a great scaffolder, you're well known.
Yes.
Yes? And your reputation as a fine bloke precedes you when you came to this project. Would you say that was right?
That's the first time I've heard such a comment, but yes, I would agree to that.
Okay.
If people are saying it.
And you concede that you have a humour, and do you concede that your reputation as a happy chappy is a reputation that preceded you when you came to this project?
Quite possibly, yes.
Yes. And that is it the case that now, Sleep White, your girlfriend, she's 6 foot, is she?
About that, yes.
Yes, thank you. Now, isn't it the case that when Sleep White came into your life, you have decided...
Well, Your Honour, I object to this line of questioning. I really fail to see the relevance of the applicant's personal relationship with Ms. Sleep White. My learned friend objected to material going in which related to art of work matters, yet he presses them in cross-examination.
Yeah.
Well, Your Honour, the purpose of my question is to understand the witness and what motivates him in these applications. And I'm putting a proposition to him, and this is the proposition, if I may put it, which is that your new six-foot girlfriend has come into your life and you've decided, for whatever reason, to change course 180% and, contrary to your previous practices, on the 3rd of April, now decide that height is a big embarrassing factor in your life. Isn't that right?
It finally got to me, yes.
No further questions.
Thanks, Mr. Furey.
Mr. Transome, can I... you were asked some questions by my learned friend about the first incident in the recreation room when the employees are watching the Game of Thrones. And on that occasion, Mr. Toll made a comment to you about, look, it's the imp. And I think you indicated that you chose to laugh along with the rest. Can you tell the tribunal why that was the case?
Certainly. In that position, I was just shocked with intimidation. I felt that I couldn't speak up and say that I wasn't comfortable with the comments he was making. I felt that would lead to further embarrassment. I even briefly considered, should I say something back to him to combat what he said to me, but then I thought that would certainly antagonise the situation, so I laughed it off and tried to be the bigger man in hope that he wouldn't comment on my height any longer or any more, and he did.
Okay. You were asked a question by my learned friend about your reaction. He used the word to the whole episode, and I understood him to be referring to the various incidents that you recounted in your witness statement. I just want to take you to the incidents where employees patted you on the head. Can you tell me how you responded to that particular circumstance?
This is a new question, Your Honour. There was no discussion, no examination in chief on this issue. It wasn't dealt with. Is it appropriate that if he's... I don't mind my learned friend raising it, but I might need to...
No, that's fine. Yeah, you can cross on it.
Can you say how you reacted to that particular circumstance, Mr. Transom?
Sometimes I would merely smile and try to laugh it off. Other times I completely ignore the person and remove myself from the situation.
Okay. I have no further questions for the witness, Your Honour.
Was there anything you wanted to cross on? No. Thank you, Mr. Transom, for your evidence. Do you want to deal with all of the evidence first before you go any further? Or that's the evidence of Mr. Tall?
That's the evidence that I intend to call.
Okay. Mr. Ruskin?
Thank you, Your Honour. I have three documents that I want to hand up. I have, I'll call Mr. Tall shortly, but there is the affidavit of a Mr. Fred Flange, who's the project coordinator of Lacking Energy. He's sworn an affidavit in these proceedings. We don't propose to call him given the time factors, but he has sworn an affidavit. I'd like to hand it up and put it into evidence. I've got copies.
Have you seen a copy of this, Mr. Farouk?
I have, Your Honour, and I have an objection to paragraph 7 of that statement or that affidavit being admitted. It relates to Mr. Flange setting out some hearsay evidence in relation to what was said to him by Mr. Transom. So there are some asserted facts there about conduct to which Mr. Flange is not witness, and in my respectful submission, that evidence should not be admitted before the tribunal.
So that's the evidence about a conversation that Mr. Tall had with Mr. Flange. Is that it, embarrassing?
That is right.
All right. Mr. Ruskin?
Well, Your Honour, I concede it is hearsay.
And you're calling Mr. Tall?
I'm calling Mr. Tall, and I say that this commission is not, as you are aware, barred from... bound by the rules of evidence and can call hearsay evidence, and I rely on two decisions which I can hand up if you wish, Your Honour, on the question of I can tell you the decisions and you let me know if you'd like me to hand them up. One is the CFMEU and Abbey Group Contractors 2013, which was a full bench decision, and the In the Fair Work Commission, a decision of Senior Deputy President O'Callaghan, in which hearsay evidence was admitted during the hearing, and the basis of that was that in the matter of the CFMEU case, at first instance, SDP Richards indicated the evidence would be weighed according to its consideration, and that the Commission is, of course, not bound by the rules of evidence. In the second matter of, and that was dismissed on appeal, in the second matter before Senior Deputy President O'Callaghan in the case of In the Fair Work Commission, hearsay evidence was admitted, and Senior Deputy President O'Callaghan said that he was not satisfied the evidence should be completely discounted. There was no evidence before him that disproved the evidence, and he thought it was indicative of a pattern of behaviour. Now, what's important in this, and we'll hear Mr. Tall in a moment, is that consistent with what Mr. Tall will say, he said to Mr. Flange that any jokes were made as friendly banter, not to call offence. That's the first response he had to his employer. And Mr. Transome appeared to participate in the banter, which is consistent with what my cross-examination has sought to elicit. And on that basis, Your Honour, I see it as you give it the weight you wish, but it has some relevance in these proceedings.
All right. Well, I accept I'm not bound by the rules of evidence and that I could admit hearsay evidence, but I don't propose to on this occasion. I'll strike out paragraph 7. My reasons are as follows, that Mr. Flange isn't to be called, and secondly, Mr. Tall can give evidence about what he told Mr. Flange.
Thank you.
I'll mark the exhibit with that, or the affidavit of Mr. Flange with that omission, as exhibit R1.
Thank you, Your Honour. I'd now like to call Mr. Tall. Mr. Tall?
Affirmation, thank you.
Please state your full name and address.
Mr. Steve Tall, 15 Mountain Street, Withering Heights, Albert Park, Victoria.
Repeat after me.
I solemnly and sincerely
declare and affirm.
Declare and affirm
that the evidence I'm about to give.
That the evidence I'm about to give.
In this matter before the commission.
In this matter before the commission.
Will be the truth.
Will be the truth.
The whole truth.
The whole truth.
And nothing but the truth.
And nothing but the truth.
Thank you.
Could you please state your full name and address for the commission, please?
Mr. Steve Tall, 15 Mountain Street, Withering Heights, Albert Park, Victoria.
In these proceedings, did you prepare a document called Form F-74?
Yes, I did.
And do you have a copy of that?
I have pages 10 and 11 of that.
Yes, thank you. I'd like to hand that up, Your Honour, and have it marked as evidence.
Mark the excerpt from the Form F-74 of Mr. Tall as Exhibit R2.
Now, what do you say about the accuracy, just take your time if you need to, of what's in that Form 74? Does that reflect what you think or does it not?
Well, it was my handwriting. You know, my hand didn't spend a lot of time on it, I must confess, but it's very brief.
And do you agree or not agree with what is written down there?
Yeah, I think that's a summary of what I think.
Right, thank you. Now, Your Honour, there is a policy, an anti-bullying policy of my client Lacking Energy, Proprietary Limited. I'd just like to show that policy to my witness.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have a copy of that policy with you?
No, I don't.
Just... Now, looking at that, did you wish to mark that, Your Honour?
Sure. Exhibit R3.
Thank you, Your Honour. Are you familiar with this policy? Do you know if that is the policy of Lacking Energy?
Yes, I recall that was the policy that was given to us when we were inducted.
Thank you.
We have induction processes, and that's when I saw it.
All right. Thank you. Now, just want to ask you a few questions. Were you interviewed by your employer in relation to the matter that's before the commission today?
A manager of Pipeline came to talk to me about it.
And
so
who
they're
was
the
that?
Contractors
yep.
that work for us.
Did you speak to anyone from your own employer, from Lacking Energy?
No.
Okay, you didn't speak to Mr. Flange?
Oh, yes, I did.
Okay. What did you say to What did you, do you remember what you said to Mr. Flange about these matters?
I was shocked.
Yep.
I said that it was just part of the friendly banter that we go on about on the offshore site. Yeah.
Did you indicate at all anything about Mr. Transome's views of these matters?
I was really shocked because I thought, Tom, you had participated in it, so.
Okay, thank you. Do you say that the conduct that's been alleged was bullying?
I'm not a bully.
Thank you.
I mean, you know, it's just all good fun. It's a high pressure environment, 20 men on a site. We all have a go, have a good fun.
Mr. Transome says he's conscious of his height.
Yeah.
Did you know that?
That he was
conscious of his height? Did he?
He never indicated to us that it was a sore point. I mean, we have jokes with each other. He has jokes with me about my glasses, calls me four eyes, takes my glasses off.
Yes.
You know, it's...
Well, I object to this evidence. That specific comment was not put to my client in the cross-examination him by my learned friend in terms of calling the comment in relation to four eyes or anything of that specific nature, Your Honour.
No, the specific allegation wasn't put, but it was put to your client that did he engage in jokes about Mr. Tall wearing glasses?
Yes, that's right, Your Honour. And my client has indicated without actually a question that that's indeed what he said, so I think
and
it's perfectly relevant.
My recollection is that the applicant in his evidence said he couldn't recall doing that.
Yes, Your Honour, but the specific allegation...
Well, if he couldn't recall the general, how could he recall the specific?
Yes, Your Honour, I won't press that matter further.
Okay.
Now, if you were conscious, if you were conscious that he was conscious of his height, would you have done anything differently or the same, or what impact would have had?
Well, we all have jokes on that site. We all muck around. We have pranks. We're conscious of safety. Of course, we won't do anything that would affect safety, but we have pranks.
Yeah.
So, are you asking me if I'd known that he didn't like a particular prank, would I stop? Is that your question?
That's
a
good question.
Of course it would, 100%, 110%. He's a top bloke.
Do you respect his work?
He's the lead scaffolder. I'm just a lowly scaffolder. I mean, I have to follow what he tells me to do. He's a better scaffolder than me. He's more experienced. He's the best rep from Pipeline. Of course I do.
How do you feel about this matter being aired before the Fair Work Commission?
Oh, look, I'm 100% against bullying. I understand why we have it, you know. I've got kids at school. I don't want them bullied. I don't want people bullied at work. And I just want it sorted out.
Okay. Now, if you were with Mr. Transome privately now, in the light of this matter, what, if anything, would you say to him?
You know, I've thought about this. And I think, you know, I've got kids at school, as I said, and if they were being bullied, I'd be horrified. So I'd want to have a drink with you at the metho. I'd have to say, apologise, you know, and ask him to come back to work, because we need him.
Mr. Transome says that you effectively encouraged others in this humour. What do you say to that?
I'm a scaffolder. I'm not a comedian, right? We have jokes. I don't think anyone's following me, right?
Thank you. No further questions, Your Honour.
Mr. Farouk.
Thank you, Your Honour. Mr. Tall, you enjoy Game of Thrones, don't you?
Certainly do.
It's your favourite series?
Oh, well, it was just a team-building exercise.
Yeah. You brought a hard disk for that series, don't you?
Legally.
You did? Okay, yeah. I'm not suggesting otherwise.
I'm just clarifying.
I'm the only one in Australia.
Thank you, Your Honour.
No, there are some pretty dark themes in Game of Thrones, aren't there?
Yeah, there's sex as well.
Yes.
Brilliant.
Yeah? It can be pretty dark as well, can't it?
Ah, dark.
Characters being pretty brutal to each other?
Oh, yes. Have you seen Vikings? Shocking.
I love Vikings myself. Mr. Tall. And one of the characters, Lord Lannister, is a small stature.
So we're talking about Tyrion Lannister here.
Yeah?
Yeah, he's a bloody legend in that series.
Okay. But he's a small stature, isn't he?
And look at all the sex he gets. He's a legend.
But, you know, when you're in the lunchroom, the rec room,
yeah,
with Mr. Transome, you know, you refer to him as the imp, don't you?
I don't recall that being made to me. I understood that we were all watching it together. Is that what you're referring to when I made
that
statement?
Well, when you used that statement, you said, "Hey, look, it's the imp."
Yeah.
You pointed at Mr. Transome on that occasion when you said that, didn't you?
I've owned up to that. We were all, you know, this was the third night of watching that. We were yelling out, making catcalls, talking about the women, you know, talking about the Tyrone.
Yep.
You know. He was participating. It wasn't as if there was silence and all of a sudden I called out, "Hey, it's the imp."
Yep. But you accept that you use that terminology to describe Mr. Transome?
What do you understand the
meaning
of imp?
No, you accept that, don't you?
Well, I want to
clarify. Did you use that terminology to describe Mr. Transome? Did you call him the imp?
The imp means a mysterious little devil.
I'd ask you to answer the question.
And he's absolutely a mysterious little devil.
I'd ask you to answer the question, Mr. Tall. Did you call him the imp?
I've said that I did.
Okay, yes.
It's not contested by.
And you were ridiculing Mr. Transome when you did that, weren't you?
No. I made a joke, just as we all made jokes about the show throughout the night.
Well, do you accept that you were making fun at his expense?
I think we all make fun of each other at expense in that sight.
So you accept that you said you call him the imp. And what was the response that you got from your co-workers on that occasion? They laughed, didn't they?
And so did he. Yes. We all laughed.
Yes?
Yes.
Do you regard your behaviour as reasonable on that occasion?
You should have heard the other comments. It looks pretty reasonable to me in light of the other comments.
Okay, so you regard your behaviour as reasonable, do you?
If Tom doesn't think it's reasonable, I've said before, then I'm happy to cop that on the chin.
Because really, you don't even now understand why Mr. Transome is upset, do you?
I think that's a fair enough comment.
Okay. Mm. And you said that in your Form F-74 that you filed in the Commission.
That's right.
Yes.
I don't think I bullied him.
And in fact, you don't, even now you don't see why he's upset, do you?
I see that he's upset.
You don't understand why he's upset, do you?
I don't understand why he's upset.
Okay. Now, it's fair to say that this behaviour to Mr. Transome has happened on multiple occasions, hasn't it?
He's put in his application. It happened three times, I think.
Yes. The very next day, when he was at work, you were working directly with him, weren't you?
I heard
what
he said.
On some scaffolding work.
I agree. I heard what he said.
And he was standing with you, constructing some scaffolding, and you said to him, didn't you, words to the effect of, "You should stand up when you're working. You're not going to get much work done on your knees," didn't you?
I did.
And that was, again, a comment directed at Mr. Transome's height, wasn't it?
I said that to him, I agree.
Yes. And on that occasion, again, you were ridiculing Mr. Transome, weren't you?
Ridicule is a very strong word. I say that we all engage in pranks and jokes, and this was part of the general culture there.
Well, again, do you accept that you were having fun at his expense?
That's what we do. That's the Australian way.
Do you regard your behaviour on this occasion as reasonable?
I'm not a bully.
That's not the question I asked you. Asked you. Do you now regard your behaviour on this occasion as reasonable?
We're not working in a law office, mate. We're working in an offshore gas plant with 20 other men. We carry on, we have jokes, we call pranks. People give me a hard time because I've got no tooth and I follow Collingwood. You know, they give me a hard time about my glasses. Is it reasonable? Well, that's just how we deal with the stress of the work.
Now, Mr. Transome has said that in his witness statement that he found this name-calling of him as humiliating. Mm. He found it personally humiliating.
I'm sorry about that, Tom.
You accept it was humiliating then, do you?
I accept that you say he's saying he's humiliated, but I didn't know that at the time.
The fact of the matter is, you don't believe Mr. Transome, do you, when he says that he was humiliated by this behaviour?
You know what? This is the first time when we got this application that I learned that he'd had a hard time at school about his height. If I had known that he'd been bullied at school about his height and this was a big issue, I would have stopped 110%.
Okay.
He's a top bloke, he's a top scaffolder.
Okay, now, but it wasn't just words, was it? It wasn't just words in terms of how you targeted Mr. Transome.
Go ahead, tell me what you mean.
On various occasions, you've approached him and patted him on the head, haven't you?
And I've said I have.
Yes. And your purpose in doing that was once again to ridicule Mr. Transome in front of his co-workers. That's right, isn't it?
Why do you keep on using the word ridicule? I mean, I get papped on the arse, Mario kisses me on the cheeks and on the lips.
Do you accept that it was patronising behaviour to pat a five-foot man in front of his work colleagues on the head? Do you accept that?
Have you seen him, how big this boy is? He's built like a brick shithouse.
I'm not talking about how he's built, I'm talking about his height. Turn your mind to his height. You accept that it was patronising behaviour to pat Mr. Transome on the head, him being 5 feet tall.
No,
you accept that?
I don't accept I patronised him. I don't accept I ridiculed him. He's a man's man and he's a bloody good bloke and he's one of the best on the site.
You don't accept it's humiliating either to pat a grown man on the head in front of his work colleagues, do you?
I don't think it's humiliating to be patted on the arse at work as well, but I get patted on the arse.
Okay. Now, the fact of the matter is, Mr. Tall, that you're really quite baffled why you're here before this commission. You don't see that there's any problem in terms of how you've behaved to Mr. Transome at all, is there?
Well, there is a problem because he's upset about it, and that's why we're here.
Okay. Now, you say that you prepared the form F-74 yourself, isn't that right?
I only have pages 10 and 11 in front of me.
Yes, but you prepared forms, pages 10 and 11, it's your own handwriting there, isn't
it? That's right.
And those were your immediate, that was your immediate response in terms of how you regarded Mr. Transome's application. Right, isn't it?
I'm not a lawyer. I just hand wrote some responses.
I didn't suggest to you that you're a lawyer.
Mm.
What I asked you is that was your immediate response to the application. You accept that, don't you?
Yes, that's
okay.
My response to the application.
And it's fair to say that the response that you've said there doesn't show any insight into the impact that your behaviour had on Mr. Transome at all, does it?
This is a court proceeding that's saying I'm a bully, and I'm not a bully. So you're absolutely right. When I wrote this down, I was not particularly happy. I thought, I can't believe Tom just didn't come and talk to us or talk to the union rep on site.
And in that application, you did not make any mention whatsoever of your allegation that Mr. Transome had made comments to you about your glasses, did you?
I work with 20 blokes. Did you honestly expect me to sit down and write out all the carrying-ons that we do on site to justify my position? I'm not going to dob anyone else in. I've said before, it's a It's a high pressure environment. There's 20 other blokes. We have jokes. He's picked out like three or four comments and turned it into this.
But you haven't made mention there at all. Do you accept that you haven't made mention there at all of this alleged allegation, this allegation that you've made, that Mr. Transom made comments to you about your glasses and called you, I think the words
he used. I didn't mention in the application, yes.
Because I want to suggest to you that that comment was never made.
I'm under oath.
I have no further questions for the witness.
Re-examination?
Yes, just in the interest of time, Your Honour, just two questions. Was it your intention, Mr. Tall, to cause harm to Mr. Transom?
Thank you. I want to say absolutely not. He's a top bloke. I want him back at work.
All right, my next and last question is, why would you think that the comments that you've conceded you've made and the physical activity, patting him on the head, why would those events, would you think, not cause him harm when you did them? Why did you think it would not cause him harm?
It's just the culture of the place. I mean, he's been around for a long time. He's done a lot of work with us as a contractor. And honestly, I thought it was a robust enough environment that if someone crossed a line, and people cross the line occasionally, that you go and talk to them about it and say, you've crossed the line, mate.
Thanks for your evidence. Mr. Brook?
If Your Honour pleases, there are, in my submission, Your Honour, there's two elements that the tribunal will have to deal with. Firstly, being satisfied that the jurisdictional prerequisites arise in this particular matter. And secondly, being satisfied that the Commission should, in the exercise of its discretion, make an order in this particular matter.
So now, in terms of the jurisdictional prerequisites, I have to be satisfied that the applicant has been bullied at work,
yes,
by an individual or group of individuals, and that there is a risk that he will continue to be bullied at work.
Yes.
By the individual group.
Yes, Your Honour.
And deciding whether or not he's been bullied at work, I have to consider whether the conduct of Mr. Tall and his colleagues was, when considered objectively, repeated unreasonable conduct towards the applicant.
That is.
And that the conduct was such as to create a risk to health and safety.
Yes, Your Honour. Those are the propositions which are perhaps most usefully set out in the decision of this tribunal, the decision of Senior Deputy President, Commissioner Hanton, I should say, in the SB matter. I can hand up a copy of that decision if the tribunal pleases. I have a copy for my learned friend. And relevantly, they're set out at paragraphs 41 to 45 of the judgment. And they are, as Your Honour has indicated, relevantly at paragraph 41, the Commissioner sets out that the question as to whether or not there's repeated unreasonable behaviour in effect requires some satisfaction that there are persistent unreasonable behaviours, and the question as to whether the behaviours can be characterised as unreasonable fall to be assessed having regard to what a reasonable person would consider, having regard to all of the circumstances, and whether that person would consider the behaviour to be unreasonable. And we say that the elements here are satisfied. We have persistent behaviour, which is in the comment in the rec room, the consequent raucous laughter, the comment on the next day, which is stand up when you're working, Those are respectively set out at paragraph 6 and 9 of the witness statement of Mr. Transom. We have continued jokes about height, the comment of Imp, Lord Lannister. We have the head patting gestures, which are demeaning gestures. And one can regard those, in my submission, as persistent behaviours, which can readily be regarded as unreasonable in the circumstances. We say unreasonable for the following reasons, and objectively so, because they are fundamentally about ridicule, humiliation, and demeaning. My learned friend would like to characterise these matters as if they were some light-hearted jokes in a robust atmosphere. We're not talking about 1953, Your Honour. We are talking about 2015 and contemporary standards of workplace behaviour. Conduct such as this, in my submission, crosses the threshold. We have a circumstance where Mr. Tall, by the evidence which came from Mr. Transom's witness statement, had not previously worked with Mr. Transom. So this isn't an exchange between people who are well acquainted or friendly. These are people who have, in circumstance, been thrown together. We have the nature of the comments, which really fundamentally constitute ridicule and are demeaning in their tenor and in the physical activities which accompany them, the patting and the consequent raucous laughter it elicits from workmates. We also have, in terms of the further element as to whether or not there's bullying behaviour, we have the risk to health and safety. I think the causal nexus is readily made out, having regard to the various statements made by Mr. Transom, which were uncontested, in terms of him feeling humiliated and distraught and losing enthusiasm for work. They're set out in paragraphs 11 and 12 of his witness statement, and also 17. And more, in a more compelling sense, we also have the medical certificate from his treating general practitioner, which indicated that he had anxiety, stress, and sleeplessness consequent on behaviour at work. And that evidence went in uncontested. So we have, in my submission, all of the elements made up. My learned friend, in relation to the issues other than the methane pub incident, has not taken issue with the fact that the behaviour occurred at work. I then move, Your Honour, to the issue as to whether, in a discretionary sense, the tribunal should make the order. And in my submission, the order should be made for a number of reasons. Firstly, we have the evidence which came from Mr. Tall. It shows, in my submission, a massive lack of insight into the impact of his behaviour. Firstly, he still seems to regard his conduct as somewhat acceptable, as a joke, seems to try to sheet blame for the hurt and humiliation. He doesn't take responsibility for himself. The tenor of his evidence is that Mr. Transom should toughen up. That, in my submission, goes to the question as to whether or not one can accept the somewhat superficial assertions made by Mr. Transom and his representative that there is no continuing risk. We have also, materially, the conduct of other workers here. The witness statement of Mr. Transom is replete with incidents where other workers themselves have made comments directed at Mr. Transom and have patted him on the head. And that material is essentially unanswered and unexplained and is before the tribunal. The tribunal, in my submission, given that that conduct has occurred and there's no material before the tribunal which would indicate that there has been any direction or interim measure put in place by the employer which is directed at preventing other workers engaging in this conduct, can reasonably apprehend that there is a continuing risk that the conduct will occur, if not by Mr. Tall, but by other workers. Furthermore, a material consideration here is the what I, in my submission, emerges from the statement that was given from the bar table, that the overwhelming concern on the part of the corporate entities here is one of business continuity. Other than the institution of an investigation, which has been indicated in the agreed statement of facts, and other than the fact that the company said, and we accept, has expressed concern about the behaviour on Mr. Transom, there's no indication, Your Honour, that any interim steps whatsoever have been taken by either corporate entity to regulate or stop conduct at the workplace by other workers, such as, for instance, steps which could be taken a direction to workers to stop taking, to stop behaving in this manner, or in fact, training. So in the absence of those steps, in my submission, it is appropriate that the tribunal make an order in the terms proposed. The order, if I could quickly summarise, requires Mr. Tall to cease making comments or engaging in the physical activities described. That's paragraphs 1 and 2. And they are limited to conduct at work, Your Honour, in the terms of the order. Paragraph 3 prohibits Mr. Tall from inciting other people to engage in that conduct. Paragraph 4 requires the first and second respondents, the corporate entities, Pipeline and Lacking, to direct their respective employees and contractors on the project not to make comments referring to the applicant's height or engage in similar physical conduct relating to the applicant's height, such as patting him on the head. Paragraph 5 requires them to conduct a joint investigation into the allegation of bullying to be completed within 14 days. And that is a respectable and reasonable time frame given what has been said as to when the investigation could be conducted. Paragraph 6 requires the respondents to provide that report to the applicant and the applicant's legal representative. And paragraph 7 requires the first and second respondents to take, I think, what is justified in these circumstances, regardless of the outcome of an investigation, which is the provision of training to the employees on the respective bullying and harassment policies of those companies at the worksite, and that to be completed within 21 days. These proposed orders in my submission deal with all of the material risks to my client and would provide a useful and proper base for him to return to work in a safe manner. If that, nothing further, Your Honour, that concludes my submission.
Thanks, Mr. Farouk. Mr. Ruskin.
Your Honour, in the interest of brevity, I will try to be brief given the time. I have a number of authorities that I'd like to hand up, which your Honour will be familiar with. I will refer to them. Your Honour, the agreed facts. We concede comments were made about Mr. Transom's height. It's also noteworthy that we were most concerned about the allegations. It's also evidence that, contrary to what my learned friend says, Mr. Tall was most concerned about what has happened and that why we are before this commission. We do not deny that some things were said about his height. Can I make this point? Height is not a protected attribute under the Fair Work Act. So the issue is not whether there was behaviour, but it really is in the discretion of what the word unreasonable means. Was it unreasonable behaviour? In one of the authorities, Ms. SB, Commissioner Hampton said it's an objective test
in regard to all the circumstances. What are the circumstances? It's an offshore gas facility. We say, according to the evidence of Mr. Tor, it's a healthy workplace culture. People working closely with one another offshore. There was in jokes. Mr. Tor was not a supervisor. He was an equal. In fact, he was as he says himself, he was someone that had a great respect for Mr. Transon. He didn't mean any harm. He liked the fellow very much. There was no abuse. There was no physical harm. There was simply no meanness. It was human. The Commission said in Mrs. Karen Harris in WorkPack, which is cited in the decision of Commissioner Wilson in YH in the Centre and others, the Commission should guard against creating a workplace environment of excessive sensitivity in every misplaced word or conduct. Workplace comprises persons of different ages, experience and personalities. They are not divine angels, they are people. Employers are required to pursue inappropriate behaviour but need to be mindful that every employee who claims to be hurt, embarrassed or humiliated does not automatically mean the offending employee is guilty of bullying. It's a very serious charge against a person that is being made. We say this about some of the submissions of my learned friend. He says there were other people involved in this, that's why you need an order. We didn't object to it. Well, we didn't object to the allegation about other people because we don't know who they are. How can we readily call evidence about what other people did if we don't know who those other people are? So we don't consent that. He says that the response of the employer was inadequate. There was no time to respond. We said in the agreed facts that we're very concerned, and before we know it, we're before this commission. We haven't had time to investigate. We haven't had time to determine whether there is a matter here that warrants us taking some action against any employee. We say that Mr. Transon did not object to this humour. Not only did he not object to it, and he agrees he laughed, and he agrees he didn't object to it, but he participated in it, we say. We say Mr. Transon is a popular fellow, and that the endearment shown toward him was manifest in the humour about him. Such is the Australian way. He did not discourage it, but not only that, he encouraged it by him being a well-known person of humorous disposition. He displayed no reaction to the effect. Indeed, he laughed. As was said in YH in the Centre, human behaviour is an interaction between two or more people. While workplace behaviour is often of a transactional or collaborative nature, a positive effect, it is not always so. People made fun of each other. That's the evidence of Mr. Tor, and he did refer to the fact that references were made to the fact that he wears glasses. It's a light-hearted environment. It makes life way. You must take into account, Your Honour, in considering the unreasonableness issue, is the conduct of Mr. Transon. The behaviour of Mr. Tor was merely workplace banter. My learned friend says you should be that Mr. Tor shows no remorse. He doesn't know what he does. He was very clear what he knew what he did. He doesn't think it was unreasonable because he thought he was laughing with Mr. Transon and that Mr. Transon participated in it. That's what he knew. Now that he knows otherwise, height is a forbidden subject, and it will be. And he's made that completely clear, which is a reason why these, if I may say, puritanical orders sought by my learned friend should not be made. He talks about 1953. It reminds me of Cromwell's England. We are dealing, as the case of Slater and Patrick Port Logistics, which was dealing with a trucking yard, the standard of conduct is, said the court, that said the commission is that of men and not of angels. In determining whether this behaviour was unreasonable, we say these factors must take into account. We say this a little more strongly, Your Honour. We say Your Honour faces the same challenge that the Grinch faced when he decided to steal Christmas. Are you, Your Honour, going to interpret this joyous lark that reflected the affection for the man, for their most experienced scaffolder, who partook in the banter as legally defined bullying? If you do, Your Honour, with respect, you'll be cutting into the Australian humour and the Australian way of life, because we Australians are self-deprecating, we don't take ourselves seriously, and we have fun. We should not have fun at other people's expense, but then when those people partake in it, it should be okay. This should be okay. Must we now, whenever there is fun about an aspect of a person, the colour of their shoes, their unshaven faces, their occasional rolls of fat, obtain an affidavit from them with their prior written consent that their jovial faces, as in the case of Mr. Transom, about humour, harmless humour, is truly reflective of their active enjoyment and participation in the banter? Because that's what's being said today. We say there was no meanness in this activity, it was reflection of affection. He may not be as tall as many people are, but he's strong, popular, muscular, good-looking and amiable. And so was the character in Game of Thrones. As Mr. Tall said, if he had known there was not, that was not something that sat well with Mr. Trampson, that would have been the end of the issue. But he didn't manifest that. And my client should not be, with respect, subject to an order of this condition because of it. As to risk to health and safety, well, Mr. Transom says he's stressed and distressed and he's provided a medical certificate. Well, there's no medical evidence in these proceedings other than a mere medical certificate. The doctor wasn't brought into these proceedings, so we can only go on the fact that he says he's distressed. Was he stressed, or, as he perhaps conceded in this commission in my last question to him, was this an attention-seeking exercise for his new girlfriend to strut his power and strut his influence? We say he has changed course completely about issues to do with his height when previously he manifested his good humour about it. Perhaps he has done so because his delightful girlfriend is 6 foot tall and now it's an issue. Perhaps he should have told us, but he didn't. If Your Honour concludes this is unreasonable behaviour, I say, Your Honour, there'll be much disappointment in our community. We ask that Your Honour could not reasonably make an order with respect to this, because there's no risk that the worker will continue to be bullied about his height. Much of that is clear from the evidence of Mr. Tall. He takes these things very seriously. Give us time to deal with this issue at our workplace. Don't make any orders. The orders that are made here are just over the top for a matter which we've hardly been able to investigate. My client, Mr. Tall, was conscious of the bullying policy. And remember, no one knew anything about Mr. Transom's concern until several rotations in on the 3rd of April. We say we are very sorry that Mr. Transom now feels this way about matters of height when he previously did not, that no harm was intended, and quite the opposite, and that Your Honour should not make such orders.
Anything brief in reply, Mr. Peru?
Your Honour, I just want to say simply that the tenor of my learned friend's submissions are these are mere jokes, but what that fails to take into account is the comment, and I'm happy to hand up this authority to the Commission in the Matterford and Coleman case, which stands for the proposition having fun at another person's, at the expense of another person, is bullying. And that's what this case is, plain and simple. That's set out at paragraph 75 of the decision of the court in that particular matter. And it's quite material to this matter. The jokes, so-called, were nothing more than bullying, plain and simple. An order should be issued to preserve and maintain the safety of my client.
I propose to proceed immediately to decision in relation to the matter. Mr. Transome's applied for an order to stop bullying. Such an application may be made by any worker who reasonably believes that they have been bullied at work. Mr. Transome is employed by a contracting company, Pipeline Contractors Proprietary Limited. Since the 17th of December 2014, he has been contracted to Lacking Energy Proprietary Limited as a head scaffolder on an offshore construction project. Pipeline has an interest in the matter as the applicant's employer. As is sometimes the case in these matters, Pipeline is not actively opposing the application, is supportive of its employee, but is seeking a workplace-based resolution of the matter. As is required in this jurisdiction, the applicant names an individual or individuals whose conduct is said to have been bullying behaviour. In this case, he has named Mr. Steve Tall, a scaffolder employed by Lacking Energy. Lacking Energy actually conducts the workplace where the alleged bullying conduct has taken place. Both Mr. Tall and Lacking Energy are also parties in their own right, and they oppose the application. The Commission can make an order to stop bullying if it considers it appropriate, and can make any order that it sees fit other than an order requiring the payment of a pecuniary penalty. Such an order may be made to prevent a worker from being bullied at work by an individual or group of individuals. But before an order can be made, the tribunal must be satisfied of two things. Firstly, that the worker has been bullied at work by an individual or group of individuals. And secondly, that there is a risk that the worker will continue to be bullied at work by the individual or group. Mr. Transome alleges he has been bullied at work. In his evidence, he referred to a number of particular incidents. Firstly, that shortly after the second rotation on the project, commencing on the 25th of February this year, one of his co-workers, Mr. Steve Tall, pointed at Mr. Transome, saying to other workers present, "Hey, look, it's the imp," a reference to a character in the TV series Game of Thrones. The next day, Mr. Tall and Mr. Transome were working together when Mr. Tall said, "Hey, Tom, you really should stand up when you're working. You're not going to get much done down on your knees." The jokes about Mr. Transome's height continued, at first from Mr. Tall, and then a number of other workers joined in. Within a few days, Mr. Transome was being addressed by the nicknames The Imp and Lord Lannister. The jokes about Mr. Transome's height continued in the third offshore rotation, and a number of workers would pat him on the head as they passed him. I accept that the conduct alleged by Mr. Transome took place. Mr. Transome also refers to an incident that took place at a local pub on the 2nd of April 2015. It's unnecessary for me to consider that matter further, having regard to the concession made that it did not occur while he was at work. Mr. Transome complained about the behaviour of Mr. Tall and others to his manager at Pipeline. As is clear from Ms. Cantilever's evidence, Mr. Transome was told that his claims would be investigated, though such an investigation has not yet taken place. The first issue to be determined is whether the conduct directed at Mr. Transome constitutes bullying at work. In general terms, bullying conduct must have the following four elements. Firstly, it must occur while the applicant worker is at work in a constitutionally covered business. There's no issue about that aspect here. Secondly, an individual or group of individuals must be found to have repeatedly behaved unreasonably towards the applicant worker or a group of workers of which the applicant is a member. Thirdly, the behaviour is not reasonable management action taken in a reasonable manner. That's not an issue here. And finally, the behaviour creates a risk to health and safety. The two issues that are in contest here are whether the conduct of Mr. Tall and his colleagues was, when considered objectively, repeated unreasonable conduct towards the applicant. And secondly, whether the conduct was such to create a risk to health and safety. The concept of repeatedly behaving unreasonably refers to persistent unreasonable behaviours and may include a range of behaviours over time. There is no specific number of incidents required for the behaviour to be repeated, provided there is more than one occurrence, and nor does the same behaviour have to be repeated. Unreasonable behaviour is behaviour that a reasonable person, having regard to the circumstances, would see as unreasonable. In other words, it is an objective test. It would include, but not be limited to, behaviour that is victimising, humiliating, intimidating or threatening. Mr. Transom is about 5 foot tall, and in his witness statement he said he was very self-conscious about his short stature. Mr. Transom also said that the conduct directed towards him made him distraught, he couldn't sleep, and he lost enthusiasm for his work. I accept Mr. Transom's evidence. I reject the evidence of Mr. Tall that the conduct to which Mr. Transom was subjected to was friendly banter. I also reject the suggestion that Mr. Transom willingly participated in the banter. I am satisfied that when considered objectively, the conduct of Mr. Tall and his colleagues constituted repeated unreasonable behaviour towards the applicant. The next issue is whether that conduct was such to create a risk to health and safety. It is the bullying behaviour which must create the risk to health and safety. There must be a causal link between the behaviour and the risk. The behaviour does not have to be the only cause of the risk to health and safety, provided it is a substantial cause. I am satisfied that the conduct directed towards the applicant created a risk to health and safety. That finding is supported by the medical certificate tendered in the proceedings, which stated that Mr. Transom was suffering symptoms associated with extreme stress, anxiety, and lack of sleep. For a worker to be covered by the anti-bullying laws, the alleged bullying behaviour must occur while the worker is at work. The expression "at work" is not defined in the Act. An employee may be at work even if required by their employer to perform work at a place other than the employer's premises, such as is the case of an employee in a labour hire business. I am satisfied that the incidents to which I have referred took place while the applicant was at work. As I mentioned previously, before an order can be made, the Commission must be satisfied of two things: that the worker has been bullied at work by an individual or group, and that there is a risk that the worker will continue to be bullied at work by the individual or group. For the reasons I've given, I'm satisfied that the applicant has been bullied at work by Mr. Tall and other workers on the site. Given the persistent nature of the bullying behaviour, I'm satisfied that there is a risk that the applicant will continue to be bullied at work by that group of individuals. On the basis of those findings, I'm satisfied that there is jurisdiction to make an order under Section 789FF of the Act. The question now is whether I should make such an order. Now, in the usual course at this point, I then raise with the respondents whether they'd be prepared to make an undertaking rather than me make an order. You will have heard Mr. Ruskin in his opening say that now that the company and Mr. Tall were aware of the sensitivity of the applicant to the remarks made about his height, that no reference to his height will be made. And you heard Mr. Tall's evidence that had he been aware of the sensitivity, he wouldn't have done those things. So on the basis of that submission and that evidence, I would probably accept an undertaking from the respondent company and from Mr. Tall that they would cease engaging in that behaviour. I would then allow the investigation to take place that Ms. Cantilever referred to. It would only take a week. I would probably bring the parties back in 10 days or 2 weeks, encourage them to have discussions about how they might best resolve the issue and deal with the matter on that basis rather than issue an order at this stage. But if we just, before we go through some of the aspects of the of what came out of the advocacy and the proceedings, if we just go to the audience for a moment. Because, look, these are issues around which reasonable minds can differ. You've heard the evidence, you've heard both arguments. The issue really comes down to, considered objectively, do you think the conduct by Mr. Tall and his work colleagues amounts to repeated unreasonable behaviour towards the applicant, Mr. Transom? So if we take a vote about that issue, do you think in the context and viewed objectively, it amounts to repeated unreasonable behaviour? All those who think it does, if you put your hands up. All those who think it doesn't. Yeah. The issue often comes up about, well, in this workplace, this is what happens, etc. But you also have to have step back and think about, well, what constitutes reasonable behaviour? Is it reasonable? If you were in the position of the applicant, is that how you would want to be treated? And look, you have to look at the context. You would have to make an assessment. Did you believe the applicant in his evidence? Did you accept Mr. Tall's evidence? I rejected Mr. Tall's evidence for a number of reasons. One, he didn't directly answer questions. And he engaged in a to-ing and fro-ing with the questioner and wanting to put forward his own views. And that's what this witness was asked to do. And often it comes down to issues like this. And it's not unusual for someone who is alleged to be a bully to be very defensive in their evidence and the way they approach it. As for the proceedings and what you've seen, I think we've all benefited from the excellent advocacy of the two advocates, Kamal Farouk from Maurice Blackburn and Nick Ruskin from K&L Gates Lawyers. You will have seen that, if we just take a couple of points from the way they presented their cases. Firstly, they identified what was agreed and what wasn't agreed. It makes the proceeding go more quickly. It limits cost to your clients. They then focused on what were the real issues in the case. It's also, if you take from the applicant's perspective, it's always important to have a clear idea about what you want and therefore to hand up, well, these are the orders that we're seeking. So everyone knows what you want. It's not unusual, I've certainly been in plenty of cases where an applicant will go on for 2 or 3 hours before I have the faintest clue about what it is that they want me to do. And ultimately you have to frame, well, here's your jurisdiction to give us what we want, here's what we want, and this is why we say you should make the order in those terms. You've also seen the challenges of cross-examination. And it is a very difficult art, and you saw both advocates demonstrating it at a very high standard. You try and lead the witness into answering, agreeing with you. It's difficult not to agree with, although the witness managed it, that You know, would you? Everyone thinks you look like George Clooney. Do you agree with that? Well, who's going to say, well, sure, yeah. And you lead the witness to agree to a series of propositions before the floor opens up underneath them. And it's how you take the witness through those, and both advocates did that. Do any of you have any questions about either the jurisdiction, or do you have any questions of the advocates? Yeah.
He said that he'd seen the policy at his induction. And so would it have been advantageous, I suppose, to have taken him through some of the attributes that were listed in the policy?
Look, it could have been operating on some kind of time constraints. That could have been one course that's adopted. That would be a reasonable course.
I mean, seeing how Mr. Tall was in the witness box, it's likely that if you took him through it and said, well, didn't this really amount to teasing, or didn't it really amount to a practical joke, he probably would have twigged pretty quickly and just denied it and said, oh, well, look, no, it wasn't teasing, because he was going along with it. And it was just part of the banter and give and take at the workplace. Anyone else?
I was interested that you struck out everything that happened at the methane. I guess what we've sort of been coached at work is that the workplace isn't just sort of bound by the physical boundaries of work. It extends to where there's a workplace relationship as well. So, yeah, I just thought you could elaborate on I'm not sure the cases where that's sort of been founded, but yeah.
Yeah. Look, I think you need to separate of two things. If we were dealing with, say, an unfair dismissal matter, then it's not unusual for out-of-work conduct, the Christmas party, etc., to impact on your employment relationship. But in this case, we didn't really have... It was accepted that what took place at the hotel did not amount to conduct at work within the meaning of the anti-bullying area. And look, I think it'd be fair to say that probably most members of the tribunal would have left it in. The same with the hearsay evidence that I ruled out as well. I'd be fair to say I'm a bit more brutal about those things. And in this case, it wasn't really going to matter one way or another, because it wasn't as if there had only been one incident at work and then there was the hotel incident. There was repeated behaviour at work over three separate work rotations. And look, I struck it out really so we could get to the heart of what was the issue. And so you don't waste a lot of time on matters that might be of only peripheral relevance. But you're quite right, for other purposes, it certainly can be relevant what your behaviour is outside work. That's probably one of the most contestable areas of in employment law, really, about what's the boundary line now between work and your private life. And it's becoming harder and harder to define that issue. I don't know about you, but if you've got a smartphone, the line is very blurred these days about when you begin and end work, even when you're supposed to be on leave. Anyone else? Yeah.
For a time, it appeared as if one of the arguments of the defence was around the fact that there was a lack of awareness about the discomfort of the victim. Whether he could have or should have raised it earlier. So at what point and how do you think that should happen, and how is that considered?
Well, I guess the first thing to note is it's not a subjective test. It's not about whether they knew that it was going to be an issue or anything like that. But certainly in deciding whether or not you make an order, you take into account, has there been an investigation, an opportunity for that to take place? It would be relevant at that point. That has the employer had an opportunity to address these issues? Orders are very rarely made in these cases, mainly because it's not unusual that the first time the employer finds out about it, about the bullying behaviour, is when the application's lodged. And they're usually pretty horrified that it's been going on, and they want an opportunity to address it. So by and large, in most cases, they're resolved at that point. And the reason why here I went to make the finding that there was bullying behaviour is partly to vindicate the position of the applicant and to acknowledge that the behaviour is not okay, to get the message to Mr. Tall that it's not okay, and then you would encourage the parties to meet and discuss, and I'd be reasonably confident in a case like this they'd reach a resolution of it without the need to go to an order. Different members might approach it in different ways. They might say, look, I don't need to decide those issues at this stage. Why don't the parties have a conversation about it and see if you can work it out? That's, you know, a perfectly reasonable approach as well. Sometimes it's sufficient for the applicant to be told that the tribunal agrees with them, that it's not okay. And then the parties can find their own solution to it. Anybody else? Okay. On your behalf, can I thank our two advocates, Kamal Farooq and Nick Ruskin? Can I also thank the Commission staff who've acted as parties and witnesses in the proceedings? Marty Wagner, our 6'2" applicant. Paul Guilfoyle as Mr. Tall. Paola Crofts as Ms. Cantilever. Can I also thank all of the staff members who've made this event possible and given up their time, including Kate Purcell, Lauren Mathis, of our engagement team, Michael Holland, and my associate Anastasia Kyriadikis. I've got some presentations to make to the advocates, but I'd invite you to thank them in the usual way as well.